Guten Tag, entertainment lovers. Being that the Oscars are only in a few days, we only have a couple more days of Leo licking his chops and hitting his vape before the Oscars. So let's cherish it while we can. In the meantime, we have a great show ahead.
We've got Whitney Perry with Hollywood headlines, Angelica Watts with music news, and a whole lot more. So get ready to kick a dead horse and then sleep in its carcass, because from Ball State University, the real deal starts now.
Hello and welcome to The Real Deal, Ball State's one and only entertainment news show. I'm Aiden Hall.
And I'm Brandon Kratkowski.
Well, Brandon, welcome to the hosting desk.
Oh, thanks, Aiden. As the head writer of the show, I figured, you know, it was about time to stop hiding behind my script and tell my own terrible jokes.
As long as I don't have to feel the complete wrath you and your writers terrible punnage for at least one episode, I'm content.
Well, let's get this episode started then. We've got Whitney Perry on hand to deliver some of the latest headlines in the world of TV. Whitney?
Mob Wife star Angela Raiola, or people knew her as Big Ange, lost her battle with cancer. The star passed away last Thursday morning at the age of 55. The reality star faced many hurdles in her health with stage 4 of lung and brain cancer. Big Ange rep Jennifer Graziano posted a statement, "I am saddened to say that at 3:01 a.m., Ange lost her battle with cancer. She passed peacefully, surrounded by her family and friends. My heart is broken for the whole family, especially her children and grandchildren, and I will never forget her." Days before her death, Big Ange was on the Dr. Oz show. She explained how she only had 30% chance of living. Ange shared, "First, I thought I was cancer-free. I was going to have a big celebration. And then a month later, I was stage 4. We will miss you, Big Ange." Well, Vis Vaughn had to school on Jimmy Fallon. The star tried his hand at the post-game box of lies during last Thursday night's episode. Before the game had started, Vaughn knew exactly how Fallon prepped his guests. "You guys know I like to accommodate the audience, but tonight is personal," Vaughn had said. Throughout the game, Fallon tried to trick Vaughn. Vaughn, of course, was not buying it and won the game. The actor lifted loser off the floor and said, "He's still the champ." This should be a funny evening. Dwayne The Rock Johnson and Kevin Hart will be your hosts for this year's MTV Movie Awards. This event will take place on April 10th. Both actors will be gearing up for their new movie together, Central Intelligence. Johnson spoke to the press and told how he is excited to be hosting. "It is an honor to be hosting the MTV Movie Awards with a guy who's not only of the funniest guys on the planet, but who is often mistaken as the twin, Kevin Hart," he said. Hart added, "Dwayne and I are perfect team for the epic 25th anniversary show. It's going to go down. I personally can't wait to see the awards. Until again, I'm Whitney Perry."
Well, thank you, Whitney. Sounds like the MTV Movie Awards are going to rock, but also have a good bit of heart to
That's
them.
That's the spirit. You delivered that obvious groaner with such conviction and enthusiasm.
Oh, I'm honored. Speaking of the MTV, I'd imagine they're going to take up the precious time with the movie awards from what that channel was originally built for, music videos.
Beyonce's been captivating and stirring the pot of the entertainment media with her own audiovisual music-based presentation and more.
Here to cover the latest Beyonce news that's got us going crazy right now is Angelica Watts. Angelica?
Now let's talk music. Artist Beyonce Knowles recently released a new single this month entitled Formation, along with a captivating music video. One day before Super Bowl 50, the Queen herself decided to drop her new single. The new song sounds more in line with her last release, 7-Eleven. It's also a little more riskier, daring, angrier and catchy than her gigantic pop hits. The chorus is definitely something that sticks with you. I still can't shake the lyrics out of my head. And lyrically, Formation is a song that Bey has never sung before. The music video is also a protest. It opens with Beyonce squatting on a New Orleans police car that's halfway submerged in water, evoking memories of Hurricane Katrina. There's also a hunting image of Beyonce draped in all black, holding up two middle fingers to the world, all in front of a Louisiana mansion. and toward the end of the video, there are cops in riot gear facing a little boy dancing. Both the cops and the little boy put their hands in the air, evoking the hands up, don't shoot gesture. Beyoncé's first time performing her new single was at the Super Bowl and was a perfect fit for such a large audience. As if her first surprise wasn't enough for her fans, the Beehive, she announced after her Super Bowl performance that she will be having an upcoming world tour. The tour is titled Formation, and Beyoncé will be donating some of the tour proceeds to Flint, Michigan in order to help with the water crisis that is currently going on. Three of Beyoncé's tour sites sold out in a matter of 4 days, and Beyoncé ended up adding two more tour dates. If you're still intending to go to one of her concerts, I would grab my tickets pretty fast. Looks like Beyoncé's fans couldn't help but to quickly get into Formation and purchase their tickets. Until next time, I'm Angelica Watts, and that's our Music Minute.
Thank you, Angelica. All right, Brandon. What Beyoncé pun are we going to pull out before the break?
I don't know. I blew through my crazy in love pun before the segment, and I don't really think I have much material left.
Beginner's mistake. You'll learn eventually. No worries.
I mean, I guess you could say that I took all my good Beyoncé pun ideas and put them in a box to the left.
Fooling me by pretending like you were out of material only to reveal another joke. Good one.
Well, thank you, Aiden. Stick around, viewers. We've still got Max Lewis with Oscar predictions and a whole lot more.
I won't make that mistake.
Is that a storm?
Sets hunters riding their pets.
We should run.
Run?
We mortals do it all the time.
Press all want to hear your story.
I was kicked off every team I was ever on before I even got a chance to prove myself. I take jumping very seriously, nearly as much as proving people wrong.
And where do you think you're going?
The Olympics.
I thought you might need this.
It's higher than you jumped before, faster than you've gone before.
You can break bones. You're lucky if you can walk again.
As your coach, I think you're crazy. But as your friend, fly.
You're Eddie the Eagle.
You all right?
Yeah, man. I'm good. You?
It's like the changing of the gods. We changing out the frauds. I gave these lions heart like my name ended in Oz.
I'm gonna find out what you're fixing to do.
Does anyone believe something very big is about to go down?
I don't have a problem taking out a cop.
There's gotta be a different way.
I do a cop just like that. Gunshots going off
that'll awake the dead. There is no limit to what desperate men will do when pushed.
Triple nine, officer down. Please respond, all units.
Welcome back to the program. As likely all of you know, our entertainment-loving selves are having our effective Super Bowl this coming Sunday.
That's right. It's that time of the year where Hollywood pets their white selves on the back, and then you decide that this is definitely the year where you stop watching award shows.
One of the most fun things to do is to guess who's winning what. Here to do just that with a handful of categories is Max Lewis. Max?
The Oscars are this Sunday, and everybody wants to know who is going to win that golden statue. Well, I am usually dead on with my Oscar predictions, so here are my picks for the winners of the three major categories. Best Actor category has many amazing and talented actors, from Bryan Cranston to Matt Damon to Michael Fassbender, but my favorite of all, Leonardo DiCaprio. DiCaprio has been nominated 4 times in acting categories and has gone home empty-handed every time. He has been in amazing movies like What's Eating Gilbert Grape, Titanic, The Aviator, The Wolf of Wall Street, and now The Revenant. He had an amazing performance in this movie, and that is why he is my pick for the Best Actor of 2016. Following is the Best Actress category, and it has some seasoned professionals in it, such as Jennifer Lawrence and Cate Blanchett, but my pick is Brie Larson for Room. This is Larson's first nomination and would therefore be her first win. She has already won just about every other award for her performance, and I think she should leave Room in her trophy case for one more. And now the biggest award in the movie industry, Best Picture. There are 8 films nominated for the Best Picture, and all of them are very well done. My personal favorite is Spotlight, the story of the Boston Globe team that uncovered a huge cover-up of the child molestation in the Catholic Church. I think this film should win, and I'm going to pick it as my winner, but I think Alejandro Iñárritu, The Revenant, has a good chance as well. I think Spotlight has an amazing story and is the definition of an Oscar Best Picture. So cozy up on your couch this upcoming weekend and see if my predictions come true. They always do. For The Real Deal, I'm Max Lewis.
Thank you for your predictions, Max. Do you have any predictions for what'll happen after the commercial break we're about to take, Brandon?
Oh, well, if I had to wager a guess, I'd say we're in for an album review from Rob White, a critical look at the work of a particular auteur from Madison McGill, and perhaps more.
Well, we'll see if any of that comes true after this break. Stick with us.
No! Emoji! Oh!
The thing about being single is, you should cherish it.
Oh my God, stop having a moment. The boys wanna be her, the girls wanna be her, the boys
wanna be her, the girls wanna be her, the boys wanna be her. You really need to get that taken care of.
What do you mean? I barely have any hair.
You should close your legs. There's a reason I stopped watching Duck Dynasty.
Is that Tom Hanks from Castaway?
Oh God, my Lord, I now begin. Oh, help me and I'll leave my sin. For I repentant thou shall be. From evil I will turn to thee. None ever shall destroy my faith. For I repentant thou shall be. Oh God, my Lord, I now begin. Oh, help me and I'll leave my sin. For I repentant thou shall be. From evil I will turn to thee.
Let us leave the Lord.
If this body vanishes, we have a potential messiah.
Where has he gone?
You tell me.
You will track down the corpse of Yeshua.
Go! Go!
What happened to the Nazarene?
He's right here. Open your heart and see.
I lost my father.
I'm very sorry.
Thank you.
Well, good luck to you.
You too. I hope you find your son.
And I hope you find your father.
You are hard to look at. You look like the topographical map of Utah.
Exactly. Down, down, free. I won't be the one ending up on the beat. Please,
the only thing you can't steal came off the plate. Stay out.
I am very turned on right now. He's gonna give it to you.
He's gonna give it to you. Welcome back. As many of you know, there's been a certain musician who I particularly enjoy that's been grabbing headlines faster than you can say, what did he get on his t-shirt?
Yes, while he's asking Mark Zuckerberg for money and sadly defending Tidal, it's almost easy to forget that Kanye West even has a new album out.
Well, here to review that album, The Life of Pablo, is Rob White. Rob?
It seems as though we can't get through a single episode without bringing up Kanye West. But rather than talking about his Twitter rants or his feud with Taylor Swift, we're going to have a little discussion over his music, specifically his new album, The Life of Pablo. As a huge Kanye fan, I was anxiously awaiting this project ever since he announced it last year. And after finally listening to it multiple times, I can honestly say I was not disappointed. This project includes features from amazing music artists such as Frank Ocean, Kirk Franklin, Andre 3000, Chance the Rapper, Rihanna, Kid Cudi, Chris Brown, The Weeknd, and much more. One of my many things that makes this album stand out is the fact that it contains many different styles of music and blends them together in this controlled chaos. For example, on the songs Ultralight Beam and Low Lights, you feel as though you're listening to some sort of gospel album. While on the songs Father Stretch My Hands Part 2 and Freestyle 4, Kanye switches the mood and flow to more of a trap music influence. There's even a song on this project called I Love Kanye, where without any instrumentation, the rapper describes how he misses his former self. Only something Kanye would do. You can also definitely hear the influence his past albums had on his current project. In my opinion, I can see some of these tracks being on projects such as Yeezus, Late Registration, and My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy. One of my favorite things about this album is the fact that it includes amazing sampling on each track. If you know anything about Kanye West, you know sampling other people's work into his art is his bread and butter, and this album is definitely no exception to this. Not only are the samples incorporated in the track itself, but also some songs are based solely around the sample. An example of this would be in the song Fade. One of my only quarrels with this album, other than the fact that it is exclusively on Tidal, was the hype it came with. Don't get me wrong, this is an amazing album, but for Kanye West, this project may not compare with some of his past albums, especially My Beautiful Dark Twisted Fantasy. To call this his best album, even though it is an opinion, is a little far-fetched. To be honest with you, I feel like the promotion leading up to this album might have impacted the true nature of his craft. Even though I believe this hype was overrated, it doesn't fully take away from the amazing music this album consists of. Overall, The Life of Pablo is definitely an album to listen to. To be completely honest, if you don't like Kanye West for any reason, you will probably not like this album. But for fans such as myself, you will not be disappointed with this project. This is either the Kanye you know and love, or the Kanye you love to hate. TLOP is an amazing project, so I'm giving it a 4 out of 5 stars. Keep doing your thing, Mr. West, and if you could spot me a pair of Yeezy Boosts, that would be much appreciated. That's my review of The Life of Pablo. I'm Rob White.
Thanks, Rob. Kanye isn't the only artist that can cause an intense inner reaction in those who consume their media. A reaction like a spark, if you will.
That's right. Nicholas Sparks is undeniably the master of his domain, a domain of attractive white people holding each other closely and gazing into each other's eyes.
Here to offer her thoughts and perspective on this work is Madison McGill. Madison?
Over the weekend, I went and saw The Choice with my friend, and it got me thinking about how much I actually enjoy Nicholas Sparks movies. I know they're unrealistic and sappy, and usually have the similar plot line of boy meets girl, they fall in love, something tears them apart, but in the end, they live happily ever after. But I know, every time I watch a Nicholas Sparks movie, I secretly wish that's how love worked in the real world. Who doesn't want to go on long boat rides, then get caught in the rain? Also, the movies have relatively good casts. For example, Ryan Gosling in The Notebook. It basically launched his career, and him and Rachel McAdams had undeniable chemistry. They're good at casting on-screen couples and finding actors and actresses that fit their character. The scenery is authentic, and they're beautifully shot. When I watch one of the movies, it makes me want to move down to a small Carolina town where everybody knows everybody and hide away somewhere on the edge of the water. They're well written, slightly cliched, but still they follow the books relatively well, so I don't sit there and think, that's wrong, that's not how it happened. I can enjoy the movie experience. And lastly, they're perfect movies to sit at home and have a girls' night. I get to sit on the couch with my friends and hang out and eat junk food and comment on how unrealistic the love story is, but at the same time, you watch Nicholas Sparks movies to enjoy the love story. Until next time, this is Madison McGill.
Thank you, Madison. Sounds like all your predictions came true, Brandon.
Oh, yeah. Except one.
And which one would that be?
Well, I said that there would be more than those two segments that just happened after that break.
But there is! We still have our final word after the next break!
Oh, yeah! It's too bad I don't read, write, or edit the scripts that I put my name on. Otherwise, I would have known that.
What?
Oh, no, nothing. Stay tuned for our final word.
For my final word, I want to talk about one of the most confusing shows on television currently, Border Town, the new show on Fox starring Hank Azaria as a border agent on the American-Mexican border in the border town of Mexifornia, is a very confusing experience of a show. It's confusingly racist and feels like a show that should have existed maybe 10 years ago, and we're just now seeing it. I wish I could say there's a redeeming quality to this show, but honestly, I've yet to see one. With its jabs at literally everything under the sun, it never really understands what it is, and the show is just a nightmare to watch. So I guess if you're looking for a descent into madness in colored animation fashion, be sure to check out Border Town today.
As for my pick for a bizarrely terrible television experience, I gotta hand it to Real Rob, auteur cinématique Rob Schneider's recent Netflix show. The only way that I think I could describe this show is a Louis from some of the least funny people on the planet. The show follows Schneider on a warped version of his day-to-day life as he deals with family, fans, and commitments. The writing is so lazy and stereotyped, Any joke at the expense of his wife, for example, boils down to, aren't Latinas loca? There's a tasteless talk about bodily functions, sex, society, and just about anything else you can imagine from a show produced by the You Can't Do It guy. The score is awful, the show's not even well shot or edited, and the whole thing just feels very, very, very cheap. So yes, if you're in the mood for the awful Adam Sandler-like version of Master of None starring your Mitt Romney-loving uncle, by all means flip on Real Rob.
And that wraps up our show for this week. Be sure to check out our website, Facebook, and Twitter pages for news and updates on all things entertainment. I'm Aiden Hall.
And I'm Brandon Kratkowski, and we will see you next time.